commissioners. I'm Senator Terry Mercer from Nova Scotia, chair of the Special Committee on the Charitable Sector. And I'd like to start by asking senators to introduce themselves, starting with the deputy chair on my left.
Good morning. I'm Ratna Omidvar from the province of Ontario.
Senator Rob Black from Ontario.
Mike Duffy from Prince Edward Island.
And as you heard, my name is Terry Mercer, and I'm from Nova Scotia. Today, we are going to continue our study, and we're going to start this morning with Juniper Locilento. And after we hear from the four witnesses, we'll go to questions. So, Madam Locilento.
Thank you. Chairman Mercer, Vice Chair Omidvar, and committee members, thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today. My name is Juniper Locilento. I'm a senior fundraiser for the YMCA of Greater Toronto, and I'm here today in my volunteer capacity as Vice President Public Affairs for the Greater Toronto Chapter of the Association of Fundraising Professionals. As a global network of more than 31,000 members, AFP works to advance philanthropy through advocacy, research, education, and certification. An ethical fundraising code has been AFP's cornerstone since its earliest days. We aim to foster a greater understanding of the value of charitable fundraising and the structures that are essential to enabling effective, ethical, and professional practice. Others have spoken about changing giving patterns, the looming social deficit, and the importance of an enabling environment. Ultimately, we all share the goal of making Canada as vibrant, safe, and successful as it can possibly be. With an estimated $14 billion annually in receded and unreceded contributions, philanthropy plays an essential role in the strength of the charitable sector and in strengthening Canadian society. As former Governor General David Johnston conveyed in his recent book, Trust, philanthropy is a key mechanism through which Canadians express their core values. Philanthropy and fundraising go hand in hand, and professional fundraisers are the link between Canadians and the causes they care about. There's a well-documented connection between asking for and securing charitable contributions. The power of the ask has been demonstrated in experimental studies. Asking not only increases the probability of donating, but also the amount that people give. AFP's own biennial study, What Canadian Donors Want, finds that 75% of those specifically asked to give will do so, compared to 53% of those who are not asked. That 22% differential represents hundreds of millions of incremental revenues that could enable charities to better address urgent needs. Realizing this growth, however, may require a change in public perception. In the Moutarde Foundation's Talking About Charities, Canadians acknowledge that fundraising is important while also illustrating their concerns. For example, from 2000 to 2013, the percentage of Canadians who believe charities are honest about how they use their donations dropped 14 points from 84 to 70%. 52% think charities spend too much on fundraising, and 34% expect all funds to go to the cause. So while Canadians' trust in charities is strong, I think it is fair to say their trust in charitable fundraising is less so. And even though donors might say they don't like being asked in a particular way, it's the essential nature of the act of fundraising, rather than its execution, that is at the heart of the issue. In fact, research suggests a conundrum in that the practice of fundraising is seen, on one hand, as too professional, and by that I mean too slick, too costly, and ethically questionable, and on the other, as not professional enough, by which I mean not adequately efficient or effective, reliant on volunteers, and lacking formal educational requirements. Because fundraisers' ability to secure gifts is influenced by how they are perceived, I suggest that it is in the public interest to accept professional fundraising as a legitimate practice. But it's not about educating the public to think differently. Rather, it is about changing underlying beliefs and attitudes. We need to ask, what is it about fundraising that we value, and how can we get other people to value these things too? The link between effective ethical asking and generous giving is especially relevant in a time of demographic change. As the committee has heard, 30% of tax-receipted contributions are being made by those 70 or older, and it's estimated that as much as $4 billion annually will leave the sector if donations from younger generations do not increase substantively. Building relationships with donors and asking for charitable support will become even more essential, although our methods must continue to evolve to include new platforms and channels. In summary, fundraisers have a responsibility to ask for donations on behalf of our beneficiaries. Guided by a code of ethics and by appropriate regulation, we will always aim to balance our duties to our donors, such as respecting their privacy or not asking in ways they don't like, with our duty to our beneficiaries to ensure their needs can be met. And having secured support from generous Canadians, we must make sure we put these funds to best use, which means that charities need to be professional and able to utilize the best talent, tools, and technologies to effect change. So, what can government do to increase trust in charitable fundraising? Firstly, foster a greater understanding of the value of charitable fundraising by ensuring appropriate representation on the recently announced Permanent Advisory Committee on the Charitable Sector. Secondly, allocate $1 million annually to Statistics Canada to collect comprehensive data that will support evidence-based decision-making about donor behaviors. And finally, establish a home in government to ensure that policy decisions are made in consideration of the sector's significant economic contribution, including revenues secured through fundraising. If Canadians can come to see fundraising as the thoughtful, ethical, and effective practice that it is and aims to be, they will be more likely to respond favorably when invited to support the worthy causes in their communities. This will ultimately lead to a stronger sector and to a stronger Canada. Thank you.
Thank you. I should declare my conflict here. Madam Lucilento and I share a history, not a recent one. I was the Vice President of Financial Development at the YMCA of Greater Toronto. I was also one of the founding members of the Association of Fundraising Professional Chapter in Toronto, and the past president of the Ottawa chapter of AFP as well. So I've got my conflicts on the table, so I've done that. And now we'll go to Mr. Eric Hibberdeli, vice president of from the Now and Forever Wildfire.
Thank you very much, Senator Mercer. And in fact, you and I also share a little bit of history as well, having sat on the Elections Canada Advisory Committee back in, well, more years ago than I care to admit, but nevertheless. I come to you in light of my experience in the nonprofit sector, having worked as the national director of a federal political party, later as national director of a wilderness conservation charity, and having followed a call to ministry, now working for the United Church of Canada, directing Francophone ministries. So despite all this path, however, I'm here with you as a representative of a for-profit organization, because this is one of the key reasons why I think that that charity laws in this country need to be modernized. The charitable sector in Canada, of course, is growing at a phenomenal rate, as you know, with significant numbers of new charities arriving each day. And donors, of course, are being solicited regularly, and relationships with those donors are deepening across the spectrum. The relationship between charities and donors, I think, is an important one, and it achieves significant positive results for our country. But at the same time, these relationships cannot, in my view, be the only way that a charity funds its work. We've all heard of social enterprise as one of the key ways in which we will find new sources of revenue and to use market mechanisms to raise funds that charities need to operate their missions. And it's my view that social enterprise in Canada is limited by a number of barriers and red tape put in place by government. And actually being able to effectively do this has proven to be an interesting challenge for me personally. The Canadian Parks and Wilderness Society, CPAWS, the charity that I was the national director of up until recently, decided to embark on a social enterprise by purchasing an office tower in the city of Ottawa as a source of revenue for which it would be able to then employ in its actual charitable activities. And so it has purchased an asset at 100 Gloucester in Ottawa, has a professional property manager, and the proceeds from the building are returned to the charity in the form of charitable donation. This has resulted in the reliable returns of almost 10% per annum to the charity on its investment made of an investment of almost $6 million. This is better than most market-based investments and is far more reliable in the long term than stocks and bonds when it comes to investing donor dollars. But achieving this has turned out to be quite complex. Charities are not permitted to run businesses that are not directly connected to the mission of the charity. And so a cat rescue charity, for example, can't own and run a hotel, or a cancer charity can't run a restaurant, just to give you some examples of what I mean. And even when it comes to owning real estate, if the charity leases out more than half of the real estate that it owns, it is deemed to be operating outside the boundaries of CRA rules. So the required establishment of a non-profit corporation, a for-profit corporation, to take ownership of the building was what CPAWS had to do in order to be able to benefit from that particular investment. So the for-profit corporation was created, CPAWS became a primary shareholder. The cost of establishing the infrastructure just to operate the social enterprise itself ended up costing over $100,000 just to actually put it into place. Not to mention that the conditions about ensuring that the for-profit businesses run at arm's length of the charity adds complexity, and then add to that that the for-profit corporation can only give 75% of its net profits to charitable resources, it becomes an additional problem. So such red tape is actually preventing charities from establishing the kind of arrangement that makes something like this possible and then sends them to other forms of simple and safe investments that achieve smaller returns, or forces them to consider riskier investments in the stock market in order to achieve better returns. Imagine, instead, an economy where charities operate for-profit businesses for which 100% of the proceeds can go directly into the charitable mission rather than simply making a profit for individual and corporate gain. I believe this is a key way that we can transform our economy, actually, with a direct impact on social, environmental, and spiritual health of our society. The rules that currently prevent charities from participating in traditional enterprise, I think, are a barrier to creating a better world and a barrier to allowing charities to tap funding sources that they so desperately need. Consider the costs of fundraising for a charity in the context where donor dollars are not unlimited. Now consider the value instead of a business operating in the traditional economy that is owned and professionally operated by a charity, with the appropriate safeguards in place to ensure that charitable revenue is protected from misuse. It's not just social enterprise, it's actually a fundamental transformation of society where profits that would otherwise go to personal gain can serve greater goals. So I strongly recommend this committee explore the rules and limitations that prevent charities from operating profit-making businesses and remove as many of those barriers as possible. And given my experience in the political, environmental, and religious sectors, I'm happy, of course, to offer any insights I have on those interesting places. And I also want to highlight that the savings to government of not needing to issue tax credits for dollars that are going into charitable activities when, in fact, they are the product of providing goods and services, I believe, is a tremendous benefit as well. And on that, I will close my comments.
Thank you very much. Madam Frank.
So thank you, everyone, for inviting me to speak. My name is Christina Frank, and I'm the Executive Director of the Canadian Association of Fairs and Exhibitions, or CAFE, which is a lot shorter. Today, in representing CAFE, I'm representing 800 fairs, agricultural societies, and exhibitions across the country, from the Canadian National Exhibition in Toronto right down to the one-day Havelock Fair in Quebec. In total, our events see 35 million people each year. Fairs are living reflections of the life and times around them. They hold deep cultural, traditional, and emotional connections to the people of their local area, and they embody a sense of community. At the same time, these events are economic drivers in their communities, and they average an economic impact of about $17.2 million on the local economy per fair overall. Small town fairs average about $750,000 in their own communities, which is a huge boon for business when you look at the small communities. There are several examples of fairs and exhibitions out there that are older than Canada itself. We have the Hans County Exhibition in Nova Scotia, which is 252 years old. Williamstown Fair in Ontario is 206 years old. Lachute Fair in Quebec, that's 193 years old. Above, I've cited numbers, $35 million, $17.2 million, impact, and so on. These numbers come from an economic impact study commissioned more than 10 years ago. They offer strength to our business case and help us and our stakeholders understand the role we play in Canadian society. It's important to understand how far we've come in these 10 years, though, and whether we are growing and growing the economy, which we at CAFE are confident we are doing. Therefore, our first recommendation to the board, to the committee, is CAFE would like to see funding provided to Statistics Canada to evaluate the social and economic impact of charities and nonprofits, including subcategories for agricultural societies, on a regular and consistent basis. This information can be used by the organizations, but also to help better inform public policy and develop sector priorities. In 2008, it was reported that our events contribute $1 billion annually to the economy, and fair-related jobs spending supports 10,700 jobs. As mentioned above, we are confident these numbers have increased, but have no tangible proof at this time. This data collection framework would allow us and other similar organizations to evaluate the progress and consider how we can better contribute to Canada's growth. It will also help the government evaluate the impact of the voluntary sector in Canada. I would really like to reiterate that the majority of our events are run by volunteers who are involved because they are passionate about the events and activities in their community. These volunteers have families and jobs and other ventures, yet they're still taking the time each year and throughout the year to better their communities by participating in their local fair, exhibition, or event. We do it because we love it. Unfortunately, though, the government is making it more difficult to do what we love by either bringing in new regulations or having excessive requirements. I can name two pieces of legislation right now in various stages that are putting our events at risk. This is unfortunate when we know the rich culture, history, and sense of community these events provide. Other government restraints include antiquated regulations as it relates to fundraising opportunities such as raffles, 50-50 draws, and so on. There's a lot of gray area around online rules and cross-provincial opportunities as well. So it would be wonderful to see a revision of the fundraising limitations and opportunities for charities and nonprofits. As well, we absolutely agree that funding provided by the government needs to be monitored and shared responsibly, and the grantees need to be organized and held accountable. However, again, for volunteers to have to go through excessive paperwork, particularly before receiving fundraising, is a frustrating and overwhelming process. In fact, it often leads to potential well-deserving applicants not applying for funding at all. Therefore, we also recommend that provisions be made to create a department in the government dedicated to charities and nonprofits in order to support them, assist with government relations, and provide additional resources and funding. We would also encourage the government in future to consider the impact of new regulations on charities and nonprofits such as ours. In reviewing what other organizations have submitted, I've also noted a request for revision on capital gains as it relates to real estate, which we at CAFE support as well. For our organizations, land is a valuable asset, and I've seen multiple cases of donors wishing to provide land to their local fair or exhibition, but the fair can't afford the taxes, and so unfortunately have to turn the opportunity down. More land for these events represents more space for ag events, festivals, entertainment, more space to be a community hub in growing areas or to help bring growth and be an economic driver in rural communities. Finally, in the same way the government is looking into supporting Canadians through purchasing food at their events, activities, and meetings, for example, it would be beneficial for multiple organizations across Canada to extend the mandate to more than just food. For example, our fairs and exhibitions do great work in terms of showcasing agriculture, promoting agritourism, and developing public trust. It would be mutually beneficial for the government to consider working with us on these projects rather than starting from scratch. It would help the government focus local and support Canadians.
Another example would be in educating the public on new legislation and guides. I think of the Canada Food Guide that came out. To educate people on that, a great way to do that would be to come to our fairs. We would certainly be willing to collaborate with the government and educate the people on these topics. This was the foundation of fairs and exhibitions, to share knowledge and best practices, and it most definitely still has a place in our events today. Charities and nonprofits need more support because thriving organizations depend on adapting to the changing landscape before them in order to survive. Therefore, I commend this committee on taking on the subject and giving it serious consideration. We are a service-based charitable organization, so the above recommendations will allow us and our individual events to grow and expand in a competitive marketplace, of which the spin-off will be to the benefit of all of Canada. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam Frank. I should tell you that the oldest exhibition that you mentioned was the Hants County exhibition. I happen to live in Hants County, Nova Scotia, so there you go. I get to see it every fall, so it's, and it gets to brings an awful lot of business to our part of the province of Nova Scotia, and historically it's a very important part, right down the road from the birthplace of hockey. So there you go. our next witness is Madame Ramsang Darsin. Please.
I'd like to thank you for being here. I actually didn't think it was real when I got the email. I'm here as an individual, but what I'm sharing comes from 20 years of experience of working, studying, and volunteering in the sector. And what I'm sharing is not just my own thoughts, but things that I've heard from the people that I work with and the people that have participated in my research. The practice that I've been asked to speak about is known as, in the U.S., as fiscal sponsorship, which is a partnership between a charity and a non-qualified donee. I refer to it as a non-charity, and this includes nonprofits, incorporated grassroots groups, and individual citizens. In the U.S., this is a well-established practice where organizations exist solely for this purpose. Both countries have similar guidelines governing the practice. However, in the U.S., with awareness and support, it has grown and flourished. In Canada, the lack of clear guidance and common language have left a lot of fear and anxiety and hesitancy to engage. These partnerships are important because they allow us to test innovative ideas and determine their effectiveness before engaging in the charitable registration process. They provide mentorship to groups working towards charitable registration, and they allow us to realize cost savings through shared services. These tools also help to increase the capacity, responsiveness, and inclusion of our sector. These partnerships allow us to be responsive to the immediate needs without having to consider the 6-month wait period for charitable registration. The example that I'd like to offer is in Calgary when we had the floods. One of the communities that was most hardly hit by the flood, the community association was the first on the ground, and the trust and relationships that they had with community members allowed them to serve people very quickly in a way that the city and the Red Cross were unable to do. So as a funder, being able to invest in them directly allowed us to respond in a timely and effective manner. For me, the most exciting use of this partnership is to enhance the inclusivity of the sector by partnering with leaders from marginalized groups. The absence of these voices in leadership roles in the sector means that we don't serve these communities very well. It's important to think of it from an equity lens. With the current system as it is, it's difficult for an individual or group that faces language or financial barriers to successfully apply for charitable status and manage all the reporting requirements. Charity and non-charity partnerships create an opportunity for marginalized individuals to lead and design programs that are responsive to the needs of their communities. This diversifies leadership in the sector and increases our understanding and ability to serve those communities. The example that I offer was a collective where we were working to address domestic violence in ethnocultural communities. We had a group of about 10 different charities, and we kept coming up against the same problems of staff, capacity building, the need for translation, and our own inability to access the people most in need. So as a funder, I disbanded the collective, and I took that funding and invested in a partnership with grassroots ethnocultural groups. And having those leaders from ethnocultural communities who had trusting relationships and were able to design culturally responsive strategies allowed us to reach some of the most isolated individuals that would have never accessed support, and it allowed us to serve them in meaningful and culturally appropriate ways. There are a lot of resources in our sector that go into diversity training and cultural competency with the goal of achieving cultural safety. But But that only happens when we're able to embrace and truly integrate individuals from diverse communities that we're serving into our decision-making structures. And I believe that this is a tool that can help us do that. Having said that, these partnerships are not ideal. We have to acknowledge that the reason that the partnerships emerged is because of the structural flaws in the system. Inherent in the charitable structure, particularly in the guidance CG004 for charities partnering with intermediaries, it is a distinct power imbalance that allows charitable organizations entering into these partnerships to exploit their partners, because the ownership and full decision-making power rests with them. We need to find a balance between full compliance that requires the charity to have full control and collaboration, which allows people to work together and bring their own resources to create meaningful change. The specific recommendations that I have is to promote and support charity non-charity partnerships through education and funding, particularly with the goal of increasing participation of marginalized groups in the charitable sector. Secondly, it would be to invest in capacity building for the sector to ensure that compliance includes increasing the capacity of the Canada Revenue staff to support and guide charities. My specific recommendation would be to include funders, both charities and government, in education efforts, because they have a reach that extends to all charities and nonprofits, and they have a mandate that allows for capacity building. I would also recommend a review of the guidelines for direction and control to increase the specificity while decreasing the administrative burden. I would recommend maintaining the requirements for written agreements and financial reporting, but reducing the requirements for governance and reporting activities. I would also like to review the guidelines for direction and control to protect against the exploitation of the non-charity partners. For example, ensuring that the administrative costs are aligned with the fair market value of the cost of the supports being provided from the by the charity to the partnership. And I would also like to add my voice to the many calls for addressing the structural barriers to participation, particularly the registration process, the creation and updating of charitable objects, and the definition of what is charitable. And finally, I would like to recommend that we begin to track diversity and representation data so that we are able to measure our progress in terms of the inclusivity of our sector. Many before me have spoken to the details of compliance and the changes that are required to ensure that. And I would like to focus on capacity building. With only 1.6% of charitable revocations resulting from an audit, I think this echoes what I see in my work. People want to be compliant. They just need the guidance and mentorship to allow them to do that. If we invest in capacity building, we will increase compliance, reduce the administrative burden, and enable our sector to truly prosper and be effective. As a closing, I would like to add that my PhD dissertation is on oppression experienced by service users and charitable organizations. Consistently, what I'm finding is that the individuals experiencing oppression, and I mean by oppression, I mean discrimination, violence, exploitation, and marginalization, the individuals experiencing this are the people with individuals with disabilities, youth, immigrants, refugees, and Indigenous peoples. So the structural inequity that begins with a lack of access to charitable status trickles down to the people leading these organizations not being representative. And that trickles down to the people that are not represented experiencing oppression when they go to receive help from the very sector that was designed to provide them with help. So those are my recommendations. Thank you for having me here today.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Now we're going to go to questions, and we'll start with Senator Omnivar.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you to all of you. I have listened to you very carefully, and thank you for the written briefs. It always helps. And I have a question for each one of you. Our time is tight, so I'm going to have to ask you, and there are other senators, and I really would like to get your expertise. So I'll start with Ms. Locilento. You have mentioned in your brief that you would like to have a greater representation on the CRA advisory panel by your association in order to enhance public awareness for charitable sector. But my understanding is that the Permanent Advisory Council's work is going to be focused on regulations of the CRA. Are you perhaps maybe willing to consider another place in government for awareness and of fundraising and charitable giving? We have heard, for instance, from the Mowat Center of Public Policy that there should be a Senate committee on the third sector, that there should be a House committee on the third sector, possibly a joint committee. So my response to that particular question.
So I think the answer to that is yes. The key is to ensure that donor interests are represented, and we believe that professional fundraisers can provide that perspective. So certainly the place in government wherever it makes the most sense to ensure that that representation exists. I do think certainly within the CRA, if the committee is focused on regulation, obviously there could be a role there, because of course we're talking about fundraising regulation, but absolutely, it's really about making sure that that voice is represented.
Thank you, and I'm going to go off my script a bit, since you are with the Association of Professional Fundraisers. It is a professional association. We have heard in the media some accounts that leave many Canadians disenchanted with charities because executive compensation is at an all-time high for professional fundraisers. We know, for instance, there is a university where I come from where the head of development actually makes more money than the president of the university. What's your response to that concern of Canadians?
I understand the concern, and I think the way to approach it is to think about what is people's motivation in making charitable gifts. And if we assume that the motivation to make charitable gifts is to make a change in the world, in whichever sphere that one wants to focus on, we want to do that in the best way possible. And does that mean that there are positions that that need that level of expertise? I think it's more important to focus on the outcomes and the impact that are made through those roles and through those institutions than getting overly focused on the details of compensation.
Okay, if I had more time, I'd follow up on that, but I need to go to Mr. Daly. You spoke about end use of funds, basically allow charities to do what they want to do, including running businesses, as long as that money is dedicated to to charitable purposes. The corporate sector, who is also in the business of running businesses and providing goods and services, may well have an issue with that. Would you comment on the issue of unfair competition for the corporate sector when charities, with all their benefits, engage in business ventures to that same end?
Well, I would say that, first of all, my intention is never to suggest that the profits made by a charity be not taxable. And okay. So let me just clarify that particular
Thank
piece.
You.
But I would like to say that at this point right now, I mean, charities can invest their monies into all sorts of different things that play up against competition of other players within society. And my idea here is not at all that somehow the charitable sector wants to undercut the profit-making sector, but instead that we find a place where if as a purchaser of goods and services that I decide, I look at two different offers and they might be the same, but I decide that at the end result, like I might want to support a cooperative, for example, or in other ways that the profits of that particular purchase of goods and services are being used in a particular way, that might be an incentive for me to make that choice. I'll admit that might be the place where there's what I might call a perception of unfairness on the part of profit-making corporations. But on the other hand, I think that is actually a helpful competition in that regard, and provides us with a place where more people in the economic sphere within Canada can feel that they are contributing to things. So imagine if you're working in a restaurant and you know that the profits of the restaurant are going to a charitable cause, that at some level your work in a restaurant isn't just at that point about serving people a meal. It's actually contributing to the greater good. I think all those things will help the sector be more competitive overall, and I don't see a problem with that.
Thank you. Ms. Frank, you are a not-for-profit. You're not a charity. You're a very big not-for-profit.
Members are nonprofits.
Your members are not-for-profits. Your members all file 1044 T-1044 forms to the CRA. would they have any objection to those forms being publicly available on the CRA's website as charities' forms currently are, to level the playing field on transparency and accountability?
I don't think so, because the way they're structured now, the information they share is already public with their AGMs and information. So financials and salaries and things like that are already publicly available to them.
Thank you. Everyone. And not to cut too much into my colleagues' times, a very quick comment and a question to Ms. Ramsunder Singh. Whatever you have said in your brief, I agree with 100%, in particular to recalibrating the relationship between charities and not-for-profits. I'd like to ask you a question about your diversity disclosure requirements. We've had Professor Dr. Wendy Sukia here, who made the same recommendations that in the T-1044 forms, charities and not-for-profits should be required to disclose diversity information. Are you talking about who's on their board of directors, who's their senior staff? Can you paint that out a little?
I'd like to see senior staff and board of directors. I don't know what's possible, but I feel like the direction of a charity is, yes, technically it is the board, but it's not always the board making those day-to-day decisions. Mm-hmm. Well, they don't make the day-to-day decisions, and so it would be important to see both.
And would you use employment equity language to define diversity?
I'm not very familiar with how they define it, but I feel like if that's what's consistently used, then I think that's what people would be comfortable with.
Thank you. I'm done.
Go to my Senator Black, Ontario.
Thank you very much. I have a clarification and then a question for Christina Frank. I know some of your members are actually incorporated under provincial statute, which would then not require them to complete the forms that that you spoke about, Senator. Just to be clear, do you see differences in charitable issues between rural and urban organizations, given that your membership covers both?
That's something we struggle with at the national level, and it's inherent in everything, every component of rural versus urban. So urban have more tight demographics, and they have more priorities. They're more trendy, for lack of a better word, whereas rural is more behind the times. They are slower to adapt technology, and so all of that is reflected in our in the challenges we face.
So what should we take into account, or what would be a recommendation that would help to level that playing field? Put you on the spot. I apologize.
Yeah, no, that's all right. I think, ultimately, is to consider the rural perspective in any setting, right? So when bringing in new technology, consider how the rural charities are going to adapt to that. When you're putting in new regulations, there's less population again, so they don't have the manpower to adapt to those things. So just consider the rural perspective, I think.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Senator Ongenberg. Oh, excuse me, Senator Duffy.
I'm interested in the whole issue of capital gains on gifts of land and property. In Prince Edward Island, we have the Lucy Maud Montgomery Land Trust, which buys the development rights to land that is in private hands to preserve it as agricultural land. It's primarily in the area where Lucy Maud Montgomery grew up and wrote her books. But one of the problems we've seen is that some of the nature trusts are constructed, or their constitution or their rules do not allow you to buy farmland for the preservation of farmland. You have to buy wild land or undeveloped land, forests and whatever. Is there a way that that bridge can be gapped so that the preservation of historically interesting, if not historically important, farmland could be brought under the umbrella? And my second part of my question is, what do they tell you at Revenue Canada when you talk about land sales and capital gains tax? I know they say no, but what is their rationale?
Sure. So I think the first part to bridge that gap, in terms of our members, we certainly have, we use the land for the for events and activities, but we have such a flexibility in a lot of our mandate that should it be to adapt to nature specifics and wildlife specifics, that there is it would take some creative thinking, and so I don't have the answer right now, but in terms of working collaboratively on that sort of thing, I think there would be potential. Again, creative thinking is required. And then the second, sorry, can you repeat the second part of your question?
Capital gains.
Yeah, oh, what do they say at CRA? Okay. I will look into that as well, because I've heard this, I've heard members come to me and say it doesn't work. I don't know why they say that, so I can get back to you on that.
Do any other members of the panel have thoughts on that capital gains piece? Because it affects not only rural areas, but it affects all kinds of things that people would like to give to charities and feel that...
I can certainly speak to the issue of the environmental question. I'll never forget a meeting I had with ranchers in Manitoba about the fact that a lot of them are on grasslands that are actually used in such a way from an agricultural perspective that is beneficial to environmental needs, and that there is this great symbiosis that happens in those places, and there's a lot of frustration with them that there isn't that kind of an opportunity to find those places. Overall, on the capital gains question, CPAWS was never involved in private land acquisition, so I can't speak to that from a firsthand experience or from a CRA experience. But I can certainly hear it from a number of ranchers who have had this kind of a challenge that would love to see that kind of thing addressed in some way.
And I would just add, we're certainly, AFP is certainly supportive of the proposal to remove the exemption as a way to further encourage charitable giving. I'm not in the position to talk about, as you're speaking, from a perspective of land use and impact, but certainly to incent giving. Absolutely, we are supportive of that.
I mean, the obvious answer is they say it's too big a gift, or it's too expensive. It's what they call a tax expenditure. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, in the overall scheme of things, when you look at the size of the federal government budget, I'm sure this is a very small part. And I think it would make a big impact on people who are living near these areas, or on the institutions that depend on donors who have art and other things that would be...
And if you add to that that right now 90% of land in Canada is publicly managed, you're right. We're talking about a very small amount of land that's even in movement from that perspective. So, yeah.
Well, thank you both. Thank you all for coming, and thank you for the important work you do. It's going to become more important as the population ages and demand for services rises. So we really appreciate your contribution.
And thank you, Senator Duffy. Senator Ondervar, please.
I'm very lucky today. I've gotten an extra round. Thank you, Chair. I want to ask you, Ms. Locilento, about that very precise figure of $1 million to be allocated annually to Stats Canada. Is that a figure that you've consulted on? Is it a figure that is mentioned in other briefs? I forget if the Mutat Foundation had a precise figure.
There's been some consultation between Imagine Canada and AFP on that number. Mm-hmm. So there has been some thought into whether or not that's the right number. I think it's probably a bit of a ballpark, but certainly we're aligned that's about the envelope.
And my question to you, which arises from Senator Duffy's question, is, you know, the YMCA is, I wouldn't consider the YMCA one of the big charities. It is not a small charity, but it's not the Hospital for Sick Children, who we will hear from later today. When the changes in the budget were made, I think in 2013, 2014, to allow for the donation of publicly held securities to charities as a charitable gift, did the YMCA and its members itself receive a bump in donations. Can you talk a little bit? Was a small pump, a big pump?
What I would say is every year, I've been with the Y for just about 4 years, and every year we do receive gifts of shares. Mm-hmm. It's not a huge amount, but certainly we do have donors who prefer to give through that vehicle and like to know they have the option. So certainly it's had a positive impact on us.
Is there a balance, and this is a question to anyone on the panel, if this recommendation goes through on extending the charitable donation facility to gifts of privately held security and real estate, the literature suggests that these gifts will go to and enrich large institutions, large charities, hospitals, foundations, not the kinds of charities that Ms. Ram Sundar Singh was talking about. Can you give us a proposal that would balance this and incent small donors who would likely give to small charities?
So, I'm going to answer your question sort a little bit sideways. One thing that we are seeing among donors, even donors who might typically have given to large institutions, is more interest in social justice philanthropy. Okay. And certainly donors think about, if I want to make a large gift to a small institution, small organization, does it have the capacity to deliver? And it will definitely consider that. But I think that we don't want to make a blanket assumption that these gifts of private securities and real estate will only benefit large institutions, because I think that donor behavior is changing, and there are donors who are interested in saying, I want to make social change on the ground. And I can do that either through a community foundation that will then support smaller charities, or directly to smaller charities. So I absolutely take your point that we need to think also about how donors who give small amounts are encouraged to give. That's certainly part of it. But I don't want us to make the assumption that only large charities will benefit from this particular proposal.
Well, the evidence so far suggests that is the case. So I'm citing the evidence. And of course, there are always exceptions to the mm-hmm. rule. But if your association can consider proposals to us, please send them to
certainly.
Us in writing. That would benefit small donors and small charities, and the same for you.
Can I add to that, actually? When you think about the rural perspective and our members, I mentioned earlier we have 800 fairs and agricultural societies across Canada. The majority of them are in very small rural communities. That's where you would see the impact of the small donors of real estate and private investments.
Your mention of the YMCA not in your thought process not being a large charity. The YMCA of Greater Toronto is the third largest Y in the world. Which puts it in a different league. Also, that the association that Juniper represents, AFP chapter in Toronto, is the largest chapter in the world. So there's a fair bit of the activity that is behind her is quite significant.
So thank you, Chair, for that correction. I am talking about total sum of dollars raised.
Yes, I appreciate that, when we hear from Sick Kids Hospital later on, we're going to be blessed with hearing from one of the best in the business. And colleagues, thank you very much. Thank you, witnesses. You wanted to make a comment. I'm sorry.
Yeah. I was just going to say that I don't think it would completely balance everything, but some education and capacity building for those smaller charities, I think, would help to make it a little bit more balanced, because what Juniper had said, if you don't ask, you don't receive. And a lot of smaller charities really don't ask. And when they do ask, they ask for quite small donations, and they don't really have an understanding of the breadth of what's possible in terms of their fundraising.
Now, Madam Ramsing Darsing, I did want to mention, I don't know whether you were aware of this, but today is Social Work Day on the Hill.
Oh.
And as a coming from the School of Social Work, I thought we should mention that today, Monday, March the 18th, is Social Work Day on the Hill. And from 4 to 6 o'clock p.m. this afternoon, There will be meetings in room C-128 of the Senate of Canada building on social work. So just you get a free advertisement because of the timing here. So if the Hans County Exhibition were here, I'd plug them too. I think I just did. Thank you, colleagues. We're going to take a very short break while we change witnesses. And witnesses, thank you. You've made a major contribution. Thank you. Thank you. Order. My name is Senator Terry Mercer. I'm a senator from Nova Scotia, chair of this committee. And today the committee will continue its study to examine the impact of federal provincial laws and policies governing charities and non-profit organizations, foundations, and other similar groups, and to examine the impact of the voluntary sector in Canada. It's our pleasure to have for this panel Mr. Reverend John Pelleau, Chief Executive Officer of the Canadian Council of Christian Charities, and from the Center for Israel and Jewish Affairs, Mr. Shimon Fogel, the Chief Executive Officer. I should also say that we were scheduled to have from the Muslim Association of Newfoundland and Labrador, Iman Hassan Khan, who's the treasurer, but Mr. Khan has fallen victim to the thing that many of us from Atlantic Canada fall victim to from time to time: Air Canada scheduling. So he was unable to make it, but I did want to mention that he was said to be here as part of our panel. So we're going to start with the Reverend Pelleau, please, and then we'll go to Mr. Fogel.
Well, thank you for the opportunity to address the committee today and to expand on my written brief. This committee is charged partly with examining the impact of the voluntary sector, and I'd like to highlight for you today the impact of religious charities on the common good. In my written brief, I outlined four categories of benefits to the public: the benefits experienced personally by religiously active adherents, the benefits they in turn give to the public, the benefits their places of worship offer to their local communities, and the benefits that religion as a whole offers to society. It is our submission that, aside from the benefits that accrue to religious people as individuals, the broader community, including the non-religious, benefit from all the other public benefits outlined in the brief. When a non-religious person receives assistance from a secular charity, they also benefit from the gifts of time and money made by religious people who learned to be generous in their places of worship. This is not an insignificant fact. Stats Canada data on giving and volunteering reveals that religious people support secular charities more than non-religious people do, greatly increasing the support that the non-religious have available to them. Many non-religious people benefit from community support programs run by places of worship, such as marriage and parenting seminars, after-school programs, tutoring, seniors programs, and adopt-a-neighborhood service initiatives. Many non-religious programs make use of low-cost or even free space available at places of worship to run clubs for scouts, arts, and sports programs. Community members in crisis often receive help from places of worship, such as counseling, referral to a social agency, or direct provision of service from a local place of worship-based food cupboard or clothing bank. The mere presence of a place of worship in a community contributes to its well-being and vibrancy in terms of its stability and its social development, as indicated by the decline in a neighborhood's viability index when a church leaves the neighborhood. Canadian society in general benefits from having a strong core of Canadians whose religious beliefs and practice and teach them to be other-centered and willing to personally sacrifice for the greater good of helping fellow citizens, regardless of their religious or non-religious beliefs. At its best, the kindness, generosity, compassion, and graciousness of the religiously active among us contributes to greater civility in our country. Religious people aren't the only people who contribute this way, but as the research shows, they are, as a group, markedly different in their pro-social attitudes and behaviors from all other Canadians, as a group. Finally, Canadian society benefits from the practice and expression of religious belief because religion and religious freedom are foundational to the other freedoms that are characteristic of liberal democracies. Former Chief Justice Dixon of the Supreme Court of Canada stated in the Big M Drug Mart decision that, quote, an emphasis on individual conscience and individual judgment lies at the heart of our democratic political tradition. Religious belief and practice are historically prototypical, end quote. That is to say, religious beliefs, such as the value and intrinsic worth of every human being, and religious rights, blazed the trail for many other rights, including freedom of assembly, freedom of speech, and freedom of the press. It is good for everyone that our society encourages the institutions, which are the places of worship, that bring people of faith together to leverage individual freedoms into communal freedoms. This is why the European Court of Human Rights stressed that the autonomous existence of religious communities is indispensable for pluralism in a democratic society. Religion provides, as detailed in the brief, a holistic mechanism unlike any other that converts beliefs and ideals into habits and practice. The common worldview of the various religions is that life is lived in community, and this entails a sense of communal responsibility to fellow believers, to neighbors, and to the community at large. Such a worldview turns the focus of the religiously observant outward and inspires them to find fulfillment in serving others, both within their places of worship and within their broader communities. Charitable status enables places of worship to do more good than they otherwise could do, and the result is, as Canadian research has found, that they give Canadian taxpayers, when all of the various tax concessions, municipal, provincial and federal sales tax, and the provincial and federal income tax, when all of those concessions are put together as an investment, they receive a 12 times return on investment. The Canadian Council of Christian Charities asks the committee to support a continuation of advancing religion as a charitable purpose by affirming in its report that advancing religion is charitable because of its many public benefits. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. We now hear from Mr. Fogel, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and to all members of the committee for welcoming CEJA's participation in this important conversation. CEJA, the Center for Israel and Jewish Affairs, is the advocacy agent of the Jewish Federations of Canada. We're a national, nonpartisan, nonprofit organization representing more than 100,000 Jewish Canadians affiliated through their local federations. Today, our testimony is offered on behalf of the Jewish Federations of Canada, United Israel Appeal. Federations are in many ways the united way of the Jewish community. They're a one-stop shop for philanthropic giving, enabling community members to support a diversity of charitable projects. Collectively, Canada's Jewish federations, excluding the direct fundraising efforts of federation-funded not-for-profit social service agencies, raise well over $120 million every year for services, programs, and initiatives to support society's most vulnerable, such as people with disabilities, low-income families, and seniors, including Holocaust survivors, educational initiatives, humanitarian and disaster relief, as well as community engagement. Like those of many charities across Canada, these initiatives, which benefit Jewish and non-Jewish clients alike, are life-changing for countless Canadians who would be at risk of falling through the cracks. Charities, like businesses, often operate in environments that are complex. Unforeseen challenges can arise, from economic downturns to natural disasters to public policy developments, requiring charities to have a degree of flexibility in delivering on their mandates. This is entirely compatible with ensuring clarity of mandate and full accountability, particularly given the taxpayer dollars are involved. With this context in mind, I'd like to share three observations in my remarks today. First, vigilance is warranted to ensure charities remain true to their stated CRA-approved objectives, particularly in the area of advocacy. To be eligible for charitable status, an organization must demonstrate that its purpose is to advance one of four categories of charitable objects. Until recently, charities were also required to ensure that no more than 10% of resources were devoted to political activities. Following a court decision last summer that struck down this provision, Bill C-86 now allows charities to conduct unlimited advocacy work, defined within the parameters of public policy dialogue and development activities, while maintaining a strict prohibition on partisan activities. This, in our view, is a reasonable and balanced approach, especially as it is clear many charities would simply not be able to achieve their stated goals without engaging in public policy dialogue. However, and returning to the set of four valid charitable objectives, it's essential that policies ensure charities only engage in advocacy activities that are well within the framework of their approved charitable objectives. To be sure, the specified purpose of a given charity should be broad enough to reflect current realities, including the fact that charities often wear many different hats. But Bill C-86 should not be used as a pretext for charities to carry out advocacy campaigns that do not directly flow from their stated CRA-approved objectives. As a corollary, we must also be vigilant, especially with respect to charitable activity that takes place outside of Canada, that the charitable activity itself is transparent and directed towards legitimate enterprises, that overseas local partners with which the Canadian-based charity secures agency agreements are bona fide, and that the ultimate recipients of the aid represent qualified donees. My second observation is that flexibility is particularly crucial in the area of donor-advised funds, which are a vehicle that Jewish federations and many other charities rely upon to encourage giving. Donor-advised funds are a valuable means for givers to establish legacy funds to advance a philanthropic goal, without the logistical challenges and the costs associated with setting up a discrete or standalone foundation. Under current policy, donor advised funds are established under the guidance and direction of the giver, who articulates a particular intent, but administered independently by the charity responsible for managing the fund. This allows for allocation decisions that best reflect the intention of the donor, but take into account evolving circumstances. Any policy changes as they pertain to donor advised funds should maintain this flexibility and not put into place narrow constraints such as annual disbursement requirements that undermine this. Financial giving is crucial to the success of Canada's charities, as our tax laws rightly recognize through various incentives. My third and final observation is that it is no less vital for the system to foster a culture of volunteers. Without an active base of volunteers, countless charitable programs and services would simply not succeed. According to Statistics Canada, more than 4 in 10 people over the age of 15 conduct volunteer work each year. Canadians perform nearly 2 billion hours of voluntary work annually, equaling roughly 1 million full-time jobs. While we acknowledge that most volunteers do so for its intrinsic worth, We believe tax laws should be amended to recognize the value of volunteering. This is especially worthy in that many volunteers may not be in a position to contribute financially and therefore contribute their time and energy instead. And while thoughts automatically turn to the younger demographic when considering this kind of program, it's important to note that the elderly end of the spectrum, those who value a charitable spirit but who may have restricted incomes, would also benefit greatly. Anecdotally, I can affirm that many seniors feel a sense of belonging and purpose through their volunteer efforts, and there is considerable social value in that alone. These considerations, too, should be valued as a matter of tax policy. There are a variety of parameters that could be explored in designing this policy, but regardless of the model adopted, it should require a minimum number of volunteer hours completed, a cap on the number of hours that may be claimed, and simple but effective reporting requirements on the part of the eligible charities to ensure accountability. CEJA welcomes the opportunity to be part of a conversation on such a policy initiative, recognizing that what I've described is simply the tip of the iceberg on a complex but promising topic. In closing, on behalf of Jewish Federations of Canada, UIA, I would like to thank committee members for considering our perspective and for your dedication to ensuring that public policy effectively supports the charitable sector to perform its vital work. And I, of course, welcome any questions or reflections. Thank you.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. We appreciate your presentation. We'll go to questions now. We'll start with Senator Omnibar.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you both of you for your time. Faith is on everyone's mind after the horrific incident in Christchurch. We've had incidences in Pittsburgh and Quebec. And in times like this, faith communities, with their considerable backing through charitable donations, come together to comfort people and to develop bridges of understanding where there is only grievance and grief. Perhaps both of you could give us some information as to what your separate institutions are doing, either separately or collaboratively, to advance multi-faith understanding.
The Canadian Council of Christian Charities represents primarily the evangelical Christian sector. We have an unrelated but a sister